thank you very much for being here tonight, and thanks for inviting me to give this talk. I really want to share these experiences with you. So I'm going to go through the first part, which is NewGrange. I'm going to tell you about the Denons, which is what my mother was from County Leitrim, and that's the second part of the story. How many of you ever been to NewGrange, the Passage Tombs? One lady. So you keep me honest, right? Okay. So it's a megalith passage tomb in Brun na Boyne, which is the Boyne River Valley in County Meath. And this is where agricultural society started. So you can see there, you know, England to the left, I mean to the right, Ireland to the left, there's a little red line that shows where NewGrange is. It's above Dublin. Dublin's down the lower right. So it's about a 2-hour drive from Dublin, and it is a UNESCO, United Nations Heritage Site. So you have to, you know, everything is controlled. You have to have permits to go in, and they, you know, they take so many people at a certain time. This is the Boyne River, where there were a lot of fights in the 1830s and 40s with the British and the Irish trying to protect themselves. Again, Google Maps, a lot of people were looking at it when I was looking at it. So you get an idea of it, but here's a better picture. And I'm going to give you the dimensions later, but this is looking at it. It is facing due south, and so we're looking at it from the north side. As I'm driving up there, and I knew very little about it other than what I had, you know, we had the permit to get in. I finally got a glimpse, and I pretty well thought that was it. And then driving the road past it, we went by it. So just tell you a little bit about it. It's 52 centuries old. 500 years before the Egyptian pyramids, 1,000 years before Stonehenge. So you think about primitive societies, the beginning of culture, wait till you see what they built. Apparently, the research I read about 4,000 BC, somewhere within a couple of centuries, there was a major shift from being hunter-gatherers and just fishers to starting to raise grain and starting to raise animals for long term. And the weather there is very similar to Oregon's Willamette Valley. Okay, is this Yamhill County or is this in Ireland? That is the Boyne River. The Passage Tomb, and while I was there, not only did I just have the most powerful experience there, but I got to experience it with a couple of an archaeological team that was there working, which was just a real honor to be able to spend some time with them. So this is long before organized religion, long before anything else. But ancient cultures, it was very common to cremate. Every culture that I've read about, from China, you name it, they would cremate, and there'd be some kind of a transitional ceremony, and that's what this was about. So it provided this kind of link to the earth, and connected to the seasons and growing cycles. The side walls, which were rebuilt, and I'll give you the time when this, so remember, it's 55 centuries old, okay? All these white rocks came from about 60 miles away, and all that had fallen down, and they rebuilt this back in 1975. The design is called a cairn, so it means the rocks, and you'll see the hallway that goes in the middle of it, is so designed that it holds itself in place. And then the mound is completely covered. It's a huge mound. And in the 55 centuries, it's never leaked once. Wish I could say that for my roof. So, so it can has these curbstones, which were also from about 80 kilometers away, which range from 6 to 12 tons. How did they move them up onto this hill? So this is what it took, 300 workers, 20 years, and it was just an amazing thing to begin to see it. This is how big it is. And you'll see the little group of people down there in the south, on the south side. That's the passage that goes back into that, and I'll show you. We were not allowed to take pictures, so I had to do some sketches of what was going in there. It's just an amazing thing. Since they've done that, they've found 35 smaller tombs, including two other big ones. Nowth is the same size, and it's now open. It wasn't when I was there, but that's the one I got to go in with the archaeologists, and it was really beautiful. And then Dowth is a third, and it was completely destroyed back in the 1800s. And I'll show you that in a minute. As you wander around, and there are 35 of these in the immediate site. I've since read that they've located another 100 of them in other locations. And imagine that over the centuries, the dirt, the wind, everything blowing, this was just a big mound of dirt. They had no idea this was underneath until they started excavating. Dowth, and I went to see it, it was ruined in 1847 because why? They'd get rocks to build roads. So that's what they would do. They would take the rocks out for them. This one is known as the Fairy Mound of Darkness. I have no idea why that. But there's no way you can get inside of it. But you see how it's all covered up? That's the way NewGrange was until they found it in the 1960s. Like I said, Nowth has just now been opened, and I got to go through it. It was a focal point of a lot of ritual activity until the time of Christ, when St. Patrick came. And I got a story about him, too. In 800 AD, this was a resident of the High King of Ireland. And there were 12 kings of Ireland, sort of like county commissioners here, I guess. I'm not too sure what it was. But just, I won't read all of this, but this is the Celtic mythology is the home of Dag na Mór. And the early church said, this is the work of the devil, stay away from it. The church didn't want anything to do with it. The most wonderful fact I found is the Cistercians of Mellifont Abbey, they acquired all of this land where these mounds were for farming in 1142, and they maintained the ownership until the 1960s when the Irish government acquired the land. Otherwise, it would have been easily destroyed. So, like I said, the entrance was found in 1699, but some guy, not the one that ruined the other one, he said, I better leave this alone. So it was rebuilt by a team of archaeologists starting in 1962. So 55 centuries ago it was in. They discovered the winter solstice phenomenon in 1967, and somebody brought me an article about it from an Irish newspaper. That was really fun. So this is the entrance. You saw it from the back where the people were down there and going in there. These stones, this is not a curbstone. Those are separate. They're into the building. But this tri-spiral design is throughout these rocks. And what research I've done on it, there's nobody really knows, but they assume that it had to do with seasons or life or whatever. But it's on many of the other larger stones. They call it, I love this name, it's very romantic, Orthostat C10. That's what the archaeologists called it. They call it Irish symbol, Celtic design, eh-eh. It was carved 2,500 years before the Celts even arrived from Europe into Ireland. There's been a lot of writing about this, but they don't really know what the meaning is, but one guy assumed it's spiral life, physical, mental, spiritual development of our human life, winding through the rotating seasons. But it is a beautiful symbol. If you've ever studied ancient symbols on rocks throughout caves around the world, the swastika is a common one, the circle, the diamond. Of course, the swastika, the Germans flipped it, they did that. But they don't really know what it means. So these are my pictures as I was walking up from the reception center, walking due east up to the entrance. Again, walking to the backside, you see some of these other mounds. My wife, Helen, were getting ready to go in. They let about 6-7 people in at a time. And you see the portal above that square? That's where we'll see the winter solstice on December 18th. When the sun comes out, assuming it comes out, it goes back and lights up the inner chamber where the transitional part was. So it's exactly positioned for the winter solstice. What they discovered in Nowth, it is exactly positioned for to the west, for the western sun, and they have yet to figure out what that has to do with it. So it is just a phenomenal piece of architecture and design from a very ancient culture. I bought these pictures because, again, I couldn't tell you. This is what it's like to walk back in. You know, it's about 6 feet tall, so if you're a few of you would have to duck as you go back in. And they have it lit for the inside. When you get to the very back, this picture one of the archaeologists gave me, there are three little chambers, and the picture didn't make very much sense. This is an aerial, top view of it. When you go back there, there's a stone that's about 4 feet by about 2.5 feet, about this tall, and it's beautifully carved out like a rock person would do now making a bowl. So that was the bowl, and then there were these three small rooms, which I had a duck to go into, with smaller stones that were carved out. They're beautifully carved out. And they don't know if this had to do with stature or where there was hierarchy. They just didn't know. But this is what is back there. And where the center part it goes up about 16 feet, and that's where the light comes in from that black, that square portal up above it. It's a phenomenal piece of work. That's my leprechaun wife, okay. So these are the big curbstones, like I said, 6 to 12 tons that came around. They were from about 80 miles away. Again, the tri-spiral design was all over it, another design. We found rocks throughout Ireland that were just in random places with different carvings on them. Some of them met words, but I didn't know what they were. And then these braces have been put up there so to protect it because, you know, there's always rain and stuff coming down on them. Isn't that a phenomenal piece of design, 52 centuries old? And like I said, these are some of the rocks that are right there at that site, but I found those in other places when I was visiting Ireland. There was one that was open. There was a team of young archaeologists, graduate students, that were working on it. We were not allowed to go in, but they were in there just literally excavating it. So that one's probably open by now at this point. But again, you see how it was all covered by dirt, even though it had rocks around the outside. So even the big one was that. It was a very, very powerful place. I spent the whole day there. Now, from where I was standing here, I turned around about 180 degrees, and I looked over, I heard the sheep and all that, and I went, what is this? It looked like a fortress kind of thing where somebody would be inside with a gun or whatever. And so again, I talked to the archaeologist, and I said, is this building part of NewGrange? No, not at all. It's called a folly. There were hundreds of them built in the 19th century during the famines by wealthy landowners that had all these servant farmers, which my family was some of them. This is a way to give them work that they could earn. So they did that. But this folly, they've discovered about 60 of those in different parts. A lot of them were buried. But I was fascinated by it because it reminded me of something down near Astoria. So this is taking a look to the north. A look to the south, very much like the Oregon Valley. So that's NewGrange and the tri-spiral design, which I found just phenomenal. I worked with a bunch of students at Sabin School about this one time, and they came up with names, but I won't go through all that. They were very brilliant in their assessments of it. If you want to find out more, basically it's newgrange.eu for the European Union. That's the best place. But there's a lot of places. Wikipedia has nice articles about it. But it's a phenomenal place. The last one I mentioned is the Oregon Irish Club, which my father founded in 1938. The Celtic Cross. Again, this is similar to other crosses and symbols around the world, but this one is very, very unique. The Celts, again, what I found was the Greeks recorded them in about 7 centuries B.C., and remember, this mound was built 32 centuries B.C. There were tribes in the Alps, and they just moved around. Everything I read, they're not a warrior culture as much as they were farming and gathering, and they integrated into local cultures. But they arrived in Ireland in 500 B.C. And then the 5th century was the arrival of Christianity, meaning St. Patrick came and saved the land. And by the way, St. Patrick, it's coming up, St. Patrick's Day, I'm going to be celebrating that. He was from Roman heritage and he lived in Wales, but that's neither here nor there. So have any of you seen this cross up at Mount Calvary? It's right, if you go up Burnside to where the big Catholic cemetery is headed west, you go to the very top, if you look over to the left, you'll see it there. There's easy parking and all that. This was funded by a Hibernian culture somewhere here in town to celebrate the 75th anniversary of the Oregon Irish Club, which my father founded. And I had the pleasure of meeting Mary McLeese, who's the president of Ireland, when she was here to dedicate it. It's a beautiful piece of work. It's worth stopping up just to take a look at the artwork. So, as I mentioned, or I was told, I grew up with 10 first cousins. I'm the youngest. There's 6 of us left. We lost one 2 weeks ago. He was 86. And we get together once a year for a picnic, the occasional funeral, and, you know, for the wedding in case of our children or something like that. And a few years back, 2 of the cousins said, why don't we go to Conan and find out what we can about this farm or ranch or something? Nobody knew anything about it. My oldest cousin, first cousin, Mary, is 88, and she grew up in the Dalles, as I was telling somebody. So we went over to Conan. We reserved the room in the place, but the, my catch line is here, 10 bucks. You'll get that story in a little bit. So knowing from Ireland, Ireland is about 350, 400 miles wide, about 850 or so miles long. It's not that big a place. So the area is Ahava County, or Ahava Parish in Carrigaline, County Leitrim. That's where my mother's, the Denons, grew up. They would travel down, you know, about 300 miles to Cork, Yorktown, and that's where the ships left. That was true for quite a few years, still is. With the help of a musician that I know, I found out that his grandparents lived right next door to my mother's family, the Denons. And he took these pictures and sent them to me. So the road, and the site is off to the left, there's nothing there. The Irish government did a funny thing back in the early 1900s, that if you didn't occupy the house anymore and there was a chimney, they would tax you. So people that moved out of houses that were falling down or rotten, they would just knock them over. So a lot of the old houses are long gone. James Murtha is a guy who was there in the 1890s, and he moved from County Leitrim, and he left his lady friend, his soon-to-be wife, Kathleen Cantwell. But he came back for her, and they married February 10th, according to the records. And then they left right away for Ireland. They arrived in Astoria, and I found it in the records down in Astoria. And there's my uncle, Charles Denon, who I do remember as a little boy, and some other people. A year from then, Thomas, who never did marry, he arrived in Condon. The census in 1911 for Ireland, and if any of you are Irish, it's all online. The Irish government's done a wonderful job with this. It showed that James Denon was a member of the family, but he wasn't living at home. It was typical to send the children away, you know, to earn keep somewhere else. But I did discover that he came on the SS Lusitania out of Queenstown in County Cork in 1912. He was 17. Well, I've done a lot of reading about that part, but when you reach 14, the boys especially would be sent to other farms to work them, and then they would earn some keep. So the first year, nothing, room and board, and after that you get a pound a month, which was a lot of money back then. They would save it for passage to go to Australia, to the United States. Of course, most of them immigrated to the U.S. and never came back, never went home again. So anyway, the idea of the cousins, well, let's go to Conan and see what we can find out. Okay. So we all drove over there, and we met at the Condon County or whatever park, and they had this lovely covered area, and we reserved it. So we're having our buffet and cooking our hamburgers and having a cold beer and stuff like that. The fellow on the lower left with the hat there is my next cousin, John Faraday. And after we were there for a while, you know, John said, "Paul, you see that place back there?" And it was about 200-300 yards back, the Gillam County Museum. "Let's go there and see if we can find out anything." Sure. So John and I went in, and it's a very old museum. They're doing more work with it now. They've got some funding to rebuild it a little bit. And they got some other old buildings, an old jail cell and stuff like that. But it's just full of trinkets, you know. But it's quite charming. There's nobody here. And all of a sudden I saw some movement on the floor. And this lady said, "Oh, I'm sorry." She says, "I was doing some filing." She says, "I'm Catherine." She says, "Oh, and I'm Paul Lyons, it's John Faraday." "Oh, what brings you here?" And John says, "Well, we're the Denons." "You're kidding." He says, "Here's the Denon Ranch." They had these large photographs, which I've been able to borrow and scan, of the Denon Ranch. It's a little closer to see what it looks like, from 1917. She says, "How long are you gonna be here?" "We're gonna be here all day, and we'll be here tonight." So I know the farmer that owns it. So she made a call. An hour later, this guy shows up in the biggest pickup I've ever seen. And he had a very elderly gentleman with him who had to use a walker. And he knew my aunts and uncles from the ranch, which was amazing. So the fellow says, "You want to go take a look at it?" And we said, "Sure." So we caravaned out there, opened the gates. We drove down to the ranch. And when we got down below, he said, "Enjoy yourselves. If you find some trinkets or something, you're welcome to take anything. Just lock the gate when you leave." This is what we saw at the top as we're driving down. You can see the house to the far left. It's kind of real gray. The barn is to the right. And this is all part of the stuff on Lone Rock Creek. So this is what we found when we arrived at the ranch. There's the house and all kinds of other things. Inside, the interior was quite fancy. It was built in 1882, what the records show. Of course, it's, you know, completely dilapidated. And then I walked upstairs. You can see the roof is already falling down up there. It's worse now than the second time I went back. But the wallpaper, there's all kinds of, there was French tile in different places. And there was one closet, and I crawled back in the closet. It was, you know, kind of grungy. I had only one rat that I found when I went back in there. And I found this shoe, and it kind of rolled up, so I brought them out. And I took those home and unrolled them. There was some old newspapers, a lot of canceled checks, grazing permits, you name it. And then I've scanned all of those and given them to all my cousins. So these are some of the things I found. A lot of the documents were from James Murtha in the 1920s. So he came back, we'll find out. But the middle one on the left over there is my Uncle Charles Denon writing something. Then there's a grazing permit for one of my uncles over near the Dalles that he had. And the best receipt was this one. Anybody remember the Russell and Gilbert Candy Company of Portland? I don't. It was over on 24th and Holiday, so near what is now, our, I think, past Lloyd Center. So, but here they bought a bunch of cases of candy, and I enlarged it on, you know, Long Tom Bar, Molasses Cocoa, Looney Bar, Humdinger. Humdinger? I think I remember that one. That was what we found in there, plus a number of other just wonderful things. So we continued to wander the ranch. We were there all day, and it was just beautiful. We walked down to the creek, Lone Rock Creek, and saw where that was. But at that time, we didn't know what I discovered later in going through the county records. So we took this picture, a selfie, before selfies, right? This is a picture of the cousins that were there that particular day. And then the record keeping, I went through at Gillum County Historical. I found this picture from 1917. Now, my aunts weren't there, so I don't know who the ladies were, but my uncles were there. But you can see it's definitely the same house. That was a real treasure to get. My wife, Helen, who's very serious about genealogy, has done a lot of work and works for the GFO. We went to, she said, let's go up there. We've been there twice to Gillum County. The first time we made an appointment to go through the court records. And my cousin has a place up there, so we stayed there. We were there at 9 o'clock. The woman took us into this room, you know, the big old record books, they're about that large, about that thick. And so she said, here it is from 1910 to 1930. And these are all the sale books, and these are all the purchase books. So Helen took the sale books, I took the purchase books, and we just started going through them. And she says, just write down in the lower corner, write the number down, then I can print them out from our microfiche. What I found was James Murtha was quite an entrepreneur. He owned a lot of property and sold a lot of property. But this is what happened. The three Denon brothers, they bought this 6,800 acres, the ranch house, several thousand sheep. Later, one of the county people found a note from a bank that's long out of business. They borrowed $10,000 just on a signature to be paid back in 3 years. And then they had a 10-year contract to pay James Murtha for this ranch. So these three guys are all in their early 20s. The Conan Globe Times, which is kind of a funny name for a little place like that, it's one of the few papers in Oregon that's yet not digitized, so I had to go through the papers and read them. But there was a picture of my aunts, Mary and Margaret, that I grew up with in North Portland, and they had a merry party during the week, and it was kind of fun. And then I found the article that I didn't know about. James Denon drowned in August of 1920. So they made the purchase in early 1920, and then the sisters showed up in the spring, and James drowned in August 1920 in the creek behind. And the report there indicates that that a log rolled over on him and he couldn't get out. My cousin John Faraday discovered that James Murtha had an $85,000 life insurance policy on James that he collected. My cousin has conspiracy theory there, you know. But I can't prove anything. But that's what we found. We found the burial sites in Condon for James Denham there. We found for a guy named Patrick McNamee, who became the straw boss for the three brothers. He was there. He drowned in the same exact location about 4 months before James drowned. Very ironic. And then the Murthas are built are buried over there as well. What we found in the records in September, the third week in September, the brothers and sisters left. They just all split. There were two more uncles that showed up, the two aunts. My mother never quite made it. She was working her way across. She was working in Vancouver, BC as a maid to a wealthy household. But they moved to the Dalles, Spokane, Walla Walla, places like that. There was no records what they did. And there were no property taxes paid for the whole time they bought it until 1938. Well, about this time, Rain Durfee, the assistant county clerk, came back in after 2 hours where Helen and I are just going through and writing numbers. She says, how are you folks doing? I said, well, we're doing fine. We've just found a lot of information. She says, I'm sorry, I forgot to ask you what you were looking for. And I had my binder and I said, well, we're looking for the Denham Ranch. I won't tell you what she really said, but she said, oh, what? She says, my grandfather, I grew up on that ranch. My grandfather bought it from your family. Where are you staying? So she went home at lunch, and it shows there that Charles Denham, Mary Denham, Thomas Denham, wife, all that, they sold this thing for $10. So Rain Durfee went home and gave me the original warranty deed, which I have in my binder up here, and I've made color copies and scanned it for all my cousins. And it shows that they paid 10 bucks. Why did they abandon the ranch? Was it because James died? I don't know. And then 10 bucks, and then they just all split for other parts of the world. Those are the questions that I kept asking. So we went back to the county courthouse again. And the lady who was the tax assessor, a young attorney, she had been doing work about it because she was kind of intrigued by it. She's the one that found the note due from the bank, and she found some other things. But the main thing is, I was telling a friend of mine, James Wygant, he's an author, and he does lie detecting, that's his profession. We're having coffee at a coffee shop, and one of my neighbors was sitting next to me, we were talking a little bit. And he heard my little bit of the story, and he says, have you read The Oregon Desert? No. So I got it from the library, and I've subsequently bought my own copy. And I said, John, why should I? I'm not telling you. Read the book. So I read the book, and here there's a page that describes the phenomenon, which is a wonderful book. I'd highly recommend it. So World War I began in 14. It ended in 1918, but there was no armistice agreement. And so we had our troops over there in Europe. And even though it was ratified in the early part of 1920, there was troops everywhere. I mean, they still had to protect things and all that. But during that entire war, our government had contracted with tens of thousands of farmers and ranchers all over the country for, meat and grain and food and everything else. They eventually pulled the troops out, and they stopped purchasing flat across the United States the third weekend in September. The same weekend, my relatives all abandoned the ranch. So again, we went back another time. There are no public records. The only thing we're able to find out is my cousin Mary, her mother told her that everyone that went over to sign the deed got $30 to cover their fuel and to spend the night in Gillam County. By the way, it's pronounced Gillam, not Gilliam, so. Nothing, whatever happened to that money, whether one of my uncles has it, we have no idea. We'll never, ever, ever find out. So we got a lot of help from the County Museum. Rain Durfee has become a good friend. She's since retired. And then the Condon Globe Times, there's a lot of articles in there from this thing.
Okay, well, thank you all for coming. Appreciate it.